I am interested in this talk in a process which was already introduced yesterday by Alexei Kuznetsov. As Pierre said, the alpha stable Levy process on the line, two parameters up to multiplicative normalization characterize this process. Alpha is the same similarity parameter. What self-similarity means. Rho is the positivity. Which means that the probability that this random variable is positive is equal to rho. And I will make this process like x. And rho will play an important role in the following computations. Rho characterizes the positivity of the process in this way, so in a one-dimensional way. Another way to see how rho measures the positivity can be seen in an infinite-dimensional way. If you consider the time where the process crosses 1, which is a well-studied random variable since the 50s, I sense that x0 is 0. Then it can be proved, it was proved, I think for the first time by Bingham, that the asymptotics, the upper asymptotics of this random variable are parameterized by rho. Probability, and this is normal because the process has more chance to be positive, so it will exit the half line quicker. Okay, but of course, well, it is not very difficult to prove now this result, but it is it has to be tested. And in the following, I will be also interested in such asymptotics in a less trivial context. So, harmonic measures contain the strong Markov. Interested in the law of the process evaluated at this time. is what I call the harmonic measure of the set A with respect to X of the process S with respect to A. On your terminology, and these objects have been the matter of countless publications starting from the very beginning of the probabilistic potential theory. And what I can say is that this is easier to compute than TA. The law of X evaluated at TA is in general easier to study than the law of TA. TA can be very difficult. It can be a very complicated random variable. So first, in this talk, I will consider two situations. The first situation is a classic situation and a one-dimensional situation. Definition of the process D is equal to 1. I have a real process and I can consider, I can study, and it was already made actually, harmonic measures of certain sets with respect to this process. And the simpler sets on the line are intervals. Stable process when leaving an interval semi-finite or finite. And here, since we have self-similarity and since we have translation invariance, this is a Levy process, the semi-infinite case will be deduced from the finite case when rescaling. Right? So it is enough to consider finite intervals. But you can also consider slightly more difficult case, which is a complementary of an interval. And you see, well, the harmonic measure depends on the starting point, x, and on the function of the left of the position where the process leaves the set. So there are two variables, and there is no way to simplify the problems with respect to the two variables. We have translation invariance, but of course the dependence in x is not trivial, right? On the other hand, in the same way as you can deduce a semi-infinite case from the finite case, you can reduce the study to the case where the interval has a fixed length. Right. And it can be, for example, take A. Belongs to this interval or A. The complementary of minus 1, 1 and X belonging to this interval. So I give the result. So, notation. I denote H. And here, let's wait, let's simplify the notation in this case. I will exclude the case where X is a subordinator, because it's easier and it can be deduced from the general case. But if I exclude this case, then the time where the stable Lady process will leave an interval is almost surely finite. On the other hand, if I consider the process enters an interval, then, as we will see, and as was already known from a long time, but I will give the history afterwards, the process may skip finite interval in infinite time in certain situations. So let me give you the result, first result of this talk, which is a bit lengthy to write. So for all x in minus 1, 1, the first measure has an explicit density. It's a bit lengthy to write, but then I will explain you the interesting features of this formula. So this is true if y is greater than 1 and hx. And the notation hat means that rho is replaced by 1 minus rho. So well, I think this is lengthy enough. And I will just write down, if you're interested in the exact expression, which is similar to this one, although it cannot be deduced, the two results are independent from one another, there is an analogous formula for... What is what? There was a question.
H-hat.
H-hat means that I replace row by row hat and row hat by row. And so here it has x by minus x and y by minus 1.
And you need y less than -1.
Yes, so y is less than minus 1. So, comments. Some of you may know this this result already. I mean, may have seen this result exposed in certain conferences. First, A and B. In the symmetric case, the computations do not really depend on the dimension, and they can be extended to the isotropic stable Levy process on RD without any technical difficulty. So this is an old result. The interest of this formula is that it extends to the whole class of stable Levy processors, and A is a result by Rogozin. Last year. And the two articles are rather tricky and rather difficult to read. Rogozin's paper relies on coupled integral equations in the same way as Widom solved some two exit problems for the stable process in 1960. It's very influenced by Widom's paper. And Cipriano, Pardo, and Watson's approach relies on the Lamberti transformation. The reason why we got interested with my co-author, Christophe Profeta, in these issues is that it is possible to find a unified and simple approach to all these results. Some other comments. So you can prove as an exercise, and this was our starting remark, that the density in A is a probability. That its total mass is 1. Why do that? It is trivial that the total mass of Hx is 1 because it must exit a finite interval. But it is rather interesting from the computational point of view. Since the measure, the density, which depends on the parameter x, involves three polynomials in y. So you have to compute an integral of the abelian type on the minus one, one, on the complementary on minus one, one, and you have to add them and to see that the addition of these two formula, which will depend on x, actually does not depend on x and is equal to one. So it's always a pleasure to play with a special function for me, and there is the special function, say, which is a hypergeometric. Hypergeometric functions solve an ODE of second order, and the fact that it solves an ODE of second order gives rise to a subspace, linear subspace of dimension 2 between different solutions of the equation, and this just means that the sum of two functions depending on x is constant and is equal to 1. If you play with this using a different integral formulae, then you find that the integral is equal to 1. This is an innocent remark, but having made this remark, you are able to solve the potential problem which is associated with a harmonic measure. Right? So. There is a formula made by Gauss among dozens of formulae. Actually, there are three formulae. Gauss, Euler. Another one. Another guy. Pfaff. Yes. Classical computes the harmonic measure is to solve a certain integral formula. Here you take x in minus 1 and y outside. So similarly as the sole computation of the the integral of the density, you can make a change of variable and replace this basically by one and this by a change of variable. And you have to add two quantities and to prove that the sum of the quantity is one. And it is also known by the general theory that the solution, this is an equation in this, you need to find this. This is the explicit potential of the stable process. And the way to solve this is simply to consider the hypergeometric function. Okay. I could go into more details, but since this is a classical issue, I prefer to skip to something which is less classical. Oh, let's make a last remark before I skip to the last. No, it does not work. The total mass of A is 1, and as was noticed already by Kiprianou and his co-authors, it is no more the case for B. This should be recalled. Alpha is greater than 1. If alpha is smaller than 1, it is known that the process is transient, and it is all the more transient than it may skip finite intervals. This was already known, but what was not known until Kiprianou's paper is the exact way it enters intervals, when it enters intervals, either alpha being greater or smaller than 1. And you can guess also that the Cauchy case, which is not a surprise for people interested in stable processes, is the most difficult one as far as the computation is concerned, because for the potentials, you have problems since you are at the limit between transients and recurrence, and you have some logarithmic term. But you can play with the continuity in the parameter and skip this computationally rather horrible case, even in the strictly stable case. What I can say is, to conclude with this classical one-dimensional framework, is that you can move towards semi-finite interval, and if you set process starting from X is also given by a density which is simpler. Was known by Port, and what is interesting is that the probability that xt is greater than 1 behaves like something constant y become minus alpha root, constant depending on x, and a non-rigorous trick in order to go back to the initial issue which interested us is to write something like which is false, all the more when the two could be considered independent. But if you admit this on the computational level, then you deduce proposed to me, actually, by Zanchi, and which I could not solve until Christophe's miraculous appearance, which Christophe's miraculous appearance is, well, miraculous for me, of course, to use this trick, right, to write this down and to play with it. So what was the problem? Markov process, and for issues with which I might have the time, but I don't think I will, connected with Borger's equation, it is interesting to investigate the first passage time of this process. Process is continuous, so you may think that it is easier, but it is of course much more difficult because the process is no Markovian process. And in particular, can be proved that theta exists and is positive and finite, but what is its value? Let me just say that if you consider the opposite problem, which is the lower value of this positive random variable, how the quantity Ps smaller than epsilon behaves when epsilon tends to zero, this is easy. This is easy by self-similarity and general result by Gennady, if I'm not wrong, about the upper tails of infinite dimensional stable vectors. There is something which is universal and which does not depend on rho and only on alpha. Here, there is something which could depend on rho because of the unilateral aspect of this first passage time problem. Nevertheless, it was not easy to guess even what theta could be. And so Christophe's approach was the harmonic measure approach. He said, let's study AS. If we can prove that the probability that AS is greater than Y behaves in a certain polynomial way, then using self-similarity, which would not be the same as for x, because a is the self-similarity index of a is not the same, right? It is 1 plus 1 over alpha. Then we will find what we are looking for. Now, let me finish this talk with a very classical computation in the two-dimensional case, which dates back to the beginning of the study of Brownian motion. Take a two-dimensional Brownian motion. And it starts from 1 and C. Where it exists, where it exits the upper half plane. So you all know that this density is Cauchy. It can be proved in a number of ways. Probably the simplest one is to remark that the quotient of two Gaussian variables is Cauchy. The quotient of two independent Gaussian variables is Cauchy. Now, let us consider a more degenerate process related to Brownian motion.
You really mean A sub S here?
A of S is the value. No, it's not AS, it's XS, of course. Of course. Sorry, AS is 1. Yes. I was a bit. Lost in my talk, it's you should read X, of course. Thank you for following my talk.
We are all hungry, I think. But
so now, consider the process X. Let's consider the slit plane. Let's start the process here. Of course, this is a very particular process because the first marginal is the speed of the second one. So here, the process goes this way, because B is positive, and B should reach 0 with the local time effect, which is of no importance for our matters, and then you have something like this, which means that something happens. It's very easy to see, but the process leaves the half plane from below, and on the leaves a slit plane from below. Excuse me, and you can be interested in computing the law of the exit, the harmonic measure with respect to the slit plane for this Markov process. And it was done. it was done in two particular situations, which is this one, when the process starts from the negative axis, and this one. This was done by McKean. And this was done by Gorkov. In 73, in 95, in 75, in 63 and 75. And most remarkably, the McKean computation gives something of the Cauchy type. So you let us start from minus one. In order to be more precise, what I'm interested in this design is the first time the integrated process reaches zero. So by symmetry for the Brownian case, I need only consider the lower half plane with this half line excluded, because if I am in the upper half plane, I will have the same pictures, except that it will be left here. But it's basically the same problem. Things will become different in the stable case, of course. But I would need only to consider the case where x belongs to this lower half plane. And T0 is the first time the integrated process reaches zero, and this time is positive even if A is zero, of course, because the speed is negative here, right? So, T0 has density. So related to half Cauchy, a transformation of the half Cauchy. And McKean's approach heavily relies on the continuity of the sample path of B and its Gaussian character. With Christophe, we propose another approach, which relies on the Millin transform, and which I will not give in detail. So now I can have that. And I for analogous formula. And most remarkably, in the McKean extension, we also find a transformation of the half Cauchy with a certain exponent. This exponent, you see here, you have here you have probability. Of the self-similarity of one in motion. This is, of course, not trivial to prove the inclusion. And here you got something, we got a precise asymptotic for all stable Lévy process, and we deduced that our original data. I'm sorry for the mistake with the B and E. I guess you pardon me, and I thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot,
Robin.
Thanks a lot for this talk. Are there any questions or remarks?
So you had mentioned that there is, of course, as you pointed out, the connection to the nice problem.
Yes.
So
what is it? You want me to explain it now? It's going to take some time, but I can do it in privacy. No. I mean, the connection is well understood from Sinai's paper. Right. I take Sinai's original paper in 92. I don't know, Pierre. If you give me 10 minutes, I can explain it to my... If I can do it.
That we have the expression...
Yes. But the excursion starts at 2:30, so we have two hours. Well, do you need 2 hours to have lunch? Well, anyway, if I can make one picture.
Right, you take.
Let's forget about burgers and see what's involved. The drift is more important than the Brownian motion in large time. Right? So this behavior is basically like t to the square. So you notice this. And you take C, K, the complex hull. In a certain set. So if you what Sinai did is that he connected this set to a certain random set associated with the Bogert equation with Bornean initial data. This is very, very, very well, right? And he said, okay, let us compute the Hausdorff dimension of this set. And this is done, basically, in Sinai's paper with this approach, computing the theta. If you show that theta is equal to 1/4, you multiply it by 2 because you have one time in this direction, one time in the other direction, and then you get 1/2. That's Sinai's result, which was actually non-rigorous, and which was proved by Bertrand. And let us say, for the aficionados or the aficionati of fraction Brownian motion, that if you take BH, fraction Brownian motion, prove that the Hausdorff dimension, Cyprian sleeps, but you should not sleep, is H. This is a golden problem, I guess. And this is going to solve.
So one bound is known.
One bound is known. But the other bound amounts to the computation of this. And there are approaches while golden. I mean, I think it's worth the sweat. And what could be done, of course, and what we are trying to do now with this stuff, is to replace B by the stable process with alpha greater than 1, in order that this process is negligible with respect to T, and the time is large. But the problem we have is the drift, because adding drift to Brownian motion does not change the matter by quasi-invariance. It should not change the matter as either in the stable case, at least, but we don't have any proofs for that. We do not know how to move from this drifted stable process, which is no more self-similar and so on, to the stable one. And even if we could handle this, we would only have an upper bound. What would be interesting is that with this exponent, the upper bound would be zero in some cases. Yes. Because this is greater than one in certain cases. The boundary would be where it is one. But we have not any. We believe that it is true, and we believe that the Hausdorff dimension, it would be twice, 1 minus twice this, something like this. But we have absolutely no idea for the lower bound, because we don't have the Hölderianity as in Handa's paper. I'm thinking I'm just talking to one person.
So we're running out of time, so let's thank Tuma again.